Hi everyone, welcome to our second lecture this semester. Today we'll talk about generics and generic data structures. Basically, it's a concept that started with C++, in which one would develop a completely parameterized data structure where the type of the elements is actually a parameter. And then you can create data structures like stacks, queues, maps, with completely parameterized for specific types. You can create a stack of person objects, a stack of frame elements, objects, and so on, depending on what you want to implement, a programming language or a queue or any other data structure. So this is a common feature that appears in all programming languages. And in Java, being an object-oriented language is very generic, and we'll talk about basically the features of the Java generic programming. So in the lecture today, we'll talk about the benefits of using generics. We will create generic classes and interfaces. We will understand why generic types improve reliability and readability. We will use and declare generic methods and static generic methods. We'll basically see how to use them and how to declare them. Similarly, bounded generic types, we'll learn how to create generic types in these data structures that extend a different another type or are subclassing subclasses of a given type. Then we'll talk about how is this implemented in Java. Java uses a methodology called type erasure that basically, in order to have compatibility with older versions of Java, it basically implements, it deletes the type once the compilation is done and everything was typed correct. So we'll basically talk about the generic types in Java and their implementation. We'll learn how to write raw types, how to convert legacy code using JDK 1.5 generics, and we'll basically understand the type erasure mechanism. And also the constraints in that type erasure infers in the Java programming language. Like, for instance, for a type that is using a generic type, for a data structure that is using generic type, you cannot create instances of this generic type at runtime because with the new operator, because the type is not known anymore. It was actually deleted due to type erasure. So we'll talk about those restrictions, and those are about creating new objects or creating arrays of such objects. And finally, we'll see a use case that uses basically generic types to implement a matrix class, where the type of the elements in the matrix, it's a parameter, and it could be a matrix of rational numbers or a matrix of doubles or a matrix of integers. So let's start from what we know from last semester. Basically, we wrote lots of problems, programs using array lists. And one thing that you may have noticed is that if you create a generic array list, this is a Java util array list that creates an array list of any type of objects, you will get these warnings to the right of your Eclipse IDE saying that basically these are unparameterized additions to that list. That we can see that we can add a Java programming string, we can add an integer, and so on. We can add any object in this array list. And one thing that we can do is to get the elements of that array list. So for instance, in this case, integer variable I is assigned the element at index 0 cast to an integer. And you already can see that this will generate an error at runtime. And the reason why is that the element at index 0 is actually a string. And this is totally common mistake, because if you do have a data structure like an array list that contains any type of elements, if you want to do anything with those elements, you have to cast them. Now, it's not necessarily that you are the one that adds elements to this array list. It may be done by a method invoked from some other class developed by somebody else. So you are not, you cannot be sure that the type of the element that you try to get from the array list is of the type integer. Yes, you can actually add an if statement that checks if the element that you got is an instance of integer, but it's not quite common that you do checks like that. Checking before casting is quite uncommon. In fact, as you remember, the casting exception is an unchecked exception. It basically allows you to do a casting without having to have an if statement before it. And the reason why warnings are good is that it actually is better to get compiler warnings than runtime errors like we would get for this program. But still, that's quite inefficient in the fact that you cannot create an array list that is mandatory that the elements are of a certain type, like integers. And up to Java 1.5, this is about 2002, basically all array lists were like that. Basically, the raw type of array list that can only can take any type of objects. Java 1.5 introduced generic types in Java. And in this case, you can see that I'm actually creating an array list parameterized on the type of the element of that array list. It has to be a string. And it has advantages. Now we can basically can add only strings and no more compiler warnings. It will also not let us add other type of elements like integers or any type of object in Java. So you will get a compiler error, and that's much better than a runtime error because basically you see it, you can, as a programmer, you can modify it and fix it yourself, as opposed to delivering some software to a customer and the customer to see some errors, like for instance, a casting error in this case. So fixed now, basically it fixed the warning and it gets it becomes a problem for the developer to implement the correct code. Again, feel free at any moment to ask me a question, if just unmute yourself or post the question in the chat if you have any questions. So what exactly are generics? That's the capability to parameterize types, usually in data structures, but can also be done in methods that are polymorphic, can take any type of element, but you parameterize it to take a specific set of elements or a specific pair of different types of elements. So with this capability, you can define a class or a method with generic types. So a class given, for instance, a data structure like a queue, but you can specify that the type of elements in this queue is a specific type, like a string or some complex type. For implementing, for instance, a programming language, you need a stack of a specific type of elements called activation records. And this generic type, which is really just a variable at the moment that you define the generic data structure, is substituted at runtime, basically with concrete types by the compiler. And you can generate, as an example, a generic stack class that stores elements of a generic type. And from this generic class, generic stack type, you can create a stack that holds only strings or stack that holds only numbers. And those are the actual concrete types that replace that generic type.
Professor Fodor?
Go ahead.
So in terms of distinguishing between like generics and like, let's say, making an array of ints, the difference between the two is that with the array of integers, you're declaring an object or you're declaring an int or an array variable specific to ints. But with generics, you could either way just declare like an array list, but not have to specify.
Exactly. So you're totally right that when you declare something like this, like an array list, it takes any type of objects. And that's something that you may not want, because you want to basically catch all type of error or majority of errors that you can at compile time. You don't want to have any kind of surprises at runtime, like for instance to try to cast a string to an integer and the program will crash. So what basically you can do by parameterizing the type, the data type, the data structure like an array list, is you restrict now the type of elements. Now, this usually works very well for classes like array list or the ones that we will implement later this semester for queues and stacks and maps. Arrays are special, as you know, in Java. They are basically, you have a reference to a block of memory that contains that many elements of the specified type. And really, the way that arrays are implemented is that they contain, it's a reference to an array, to a block of memory that has references to if the type is a string, for instance. So of the element is a string. So really what we will try to do is to implement classes, like for instance, ArrayList or queue or stack. So it's a little bit different than arrays. It's when we use generics, we actually use them for creating classes, generic classes that take the generic type as the parameter. I don't know if this really responds to your question, but does it?
I think it does. Like an array is purely an object, it's purely an object, but rather with generics, you can
parameterize the type of classes. Yeah.
Okay, that makes more sense. Thank you.
Welcome. So there are a lot of benefits of generics. First of all is that it enables some errors to be detected at compile time rather than at runtime. A generic class or method permits you to specify the allowable types of objects. You don't have to basically only work for all generic objects, but only to specify that this will work for strings or this will work for integers. And if you try to use the class with an incompatible object, you will get a compiler error. And we'll see it through examples next. So first of all, we start with an example that we saw last semester, the interface comparable. So if you remember, comparable would take any object and it will try to compare it with the current object. So if a class implements comparable, like for instance, a date implements comparable, you would compare a date with any other object. And of course, if you write such a program that creates a comparable object C as a new date, and then you would try to compare C to a string, this would not give you a compiler error. It will give you a runtime error, and those are not good. It will crash the program, and that's not basically good to show a customer that your program can crash. Since Java 1.5, because we have parameterizable types, now comparable is parameterized on the type of the object that is we are trying to compare the current object with. So for instance, if you have a date, then the comparable object is actually of the type date. And now if you would try to compare it with a string, you will get a compiler error, which is okay because we'll fix it as developers. We'll know now this is impossible. We cannot compare dates with strings. So really what we will learn about today is how to declare classes that are parameterized on a specific type, and then how to use those parameterized classes to create new variables that now know that was the actual type of the object, like for instance, in this case, a date. So this was introduced by Java 1.5 and is used for the entire Java Collections framework. which we'll talk about next class. Part of the Java collection framework is the Java util ArrayList. So prior to Java 1.5, an ArrayList was defined as, we actually defined it last semester, is basically a collection of any type of objects. We would be able to add new objects to it, add objects at a certain index, clear all the objects from the ArrayList, and so on. Check for contains, and get the object at a given index and return it, and we will have to cast it to a specific type if we want to actually use it. We would get the index of an object, and so on. So basically, these are all methods that we discussed about in ArrayList last semester. This semester, we'll basically see that actually the implementation of ArrayList is parameterized on the type of the element. And the advantage of that is that once we create the ArrayList, we can only add elements without the compiler error of that type. So if you create an ArrayList of strings, then the add method will only work for strings. You cannot pass an integer to it. You cannot pass an object, a general object to it, and so on. Now, the get method will actually return an object of the type string, in the case that you created an array of strings. So you don't need to cast anymore the object. So basically, the whole implementation of the methods that are available in the API are parameterized to that type. So this allows you to actually make only valid operations or legal operations on the ArrayList. You can only add objects of the type that you parameterize the ArrayList on. You can only get objects of that type, and now they are of that type. You don't need to cast them anymore. And similarly, you can set elements in the array to elements in the ArrayList to elements of that type. So you have a lot of advantages that basically are given by the fact that you use generics. So
Professor,
go ahead.
Just like if you look at the class like ArrayList, so when a method is made in ArrayList, do you have to also like write what will happen, like how it handles generics? Like is that like do you have to? Okay.
Yes. So we'll see when we'll start to write our own generic classes that you basically are going to look at this one, pop. And it basically says, I will return an object of the type E. So the variable, the internal variable O is defined on the of the type E. And we basically remove from that list of elements, which is, so here I'm implementing a stack of elements of the type E using an internal data field of the type ArrayList of elements of the type E. So now a lot of features are actually embedded in this code. First of all, in this push method, we actually, the remove method actually returns an element of the type E because that list was parameterized on the type E. And then when we return the object O, it actually returns an object of the type E. So basically, this E is really a variable here, but once we create a generic stack, it changes the types of everything, the ArrayList that is used as a local, as a data field in that class, the type returned by peak, the type that the argument, the first argument of push is, and so on. So it's really, in some sense, in some languages, is actually implemented by rewriting. It's like a macro, that the moment that you actually, usually in interpreters do that, that you actually create a generic stack of a specific type of elements like integers, it will create a generic stack for integers. So now you basically, it's kind of rewriting this, but the type E is here is everywhere integer. In Java is a little bit different. Basically, it only uses this at compile time. It only uses this when actually it tries to compile this main method and it sees that I'm pushing an integer and that is in accordance to the type that is taken by this class. and of course by the push method, because that type is now the type that the push method takes. So in some respects, you can actually think about it as a rewriting, that if you create a stack of integers, it basically all the methods here will, this will be integer. Peek returns an integer, push takes an integer, pop returns an integer, and so on. If you create a stack of strings, it basically creates a stack that all of these E's are strings. Now, in Java, the only thing that this is used for is at compile time to check the correctness of arguments, that you are going to push in the second stack only strings, and in the second, in the first stack only integers. And when you return something, it returns of that type. So type checking is affected by the generic types. But we'll do this in a couple of minutes. So let's actually go back to see the advantages of basically generics, unless there are more questions. I see there is a question in the chat. If you define a generic type, is it required that you provide the type when creating an object of that class, or will just default to object? So it will default to object. So ArrayList, for instance, we used it as default type object, but those warnings appeared in the code that we saw last semester. So you will have these warnings in IDE, in any IDE, in Eclipse, in NetBeans, IntelliJ, and so on. Chauduri is asking, I mean, the class ArrayList will still be declared without generics. So it's actually declared with generics, but if you don't pass a parameterized type, it takes the super type of all classes in Java, which is object. So you are right. It will default to object. No, you cannot. So Adit is asking, can you change the type that ArrayList uses after declaring it? You cannot. Once, so for instance, actually what actually matters in here is that when you declare the variable list, you declare it of the type ArrayList of strings. So you don't even have to specify when you actually create it that this is an ArrayList of strings. This is optional. It's a good practice to put here the type, this is an ArrayList of strings, but actually this is by default the type that is given to you by the declaration of that variable. So really this is optional. You always have to put it of the same type, otherwise you will get a compiler error, but it's optional. You can basically declare Java ArrayList list of strings equal with a new ArrayList, and you cannot assign to ArrayList an ArrayList of integers. That will be a compiler error. But then when comparing, like in the comparable interface, you say you try to get the maximum between a string and an integer, you will get a compiler error. So what will happen if we go to comparable? So let's assume that you have a max method, and that max method, it's basically also parameterized on a type. We will talk about methods that are parameterized to a type. And then the type of the two objects or the array of objects that that max method takes is parameterized to E. So it basically means that all of the elements that you try to create the maximum between must be of the same type. So that's a very good idea to actually, I was actually working on a homework of several problems that use generics. And I think your max is a really good idea, because it basically, you would have to create a max parameterized on some type E between two elements, let's say. So I will develop that in a little bit more form, and then I will actually also implement it and show you the solution. Okay, good. So let's actually continue. and then we'll get to programming these things. So the first problem, basically the advantages of generics. First advantage is that you have compiler error versus runtime errors. And that's really, really important. And let me actually emphasize this, that you will not get a compiler error when you try to add to, in this case, you will get, because I created an array list parameterized for strings. But this is still much better to get a compiler error than to get a runtime error if this was not the case here. And you basically can add strings, integers, and so on. Because when you try to get them, you basically will not have to, will cast them. So this is the second advantage, no casting needed. So in this example, we create an array list of strings, and we can add strings, but prior to Java 1.5, you would have to cast the result from the get method, get of zero in this case, to a string. Since Java 1.5, if you use parameterized types, you will basically be able to get the element of the type that you actually need. So that's the second advantage. In some ways, a disadvantage, but it's really not really a disadvantage, is the fact that in Java you have two types, two categories of types. You have primitive types and you have reference types. So primitive types cannot be taken as the generic type. You cannot take int or double or char as the generic type for the type of elements in an array list. So this would be a compiler error, but really what you can do is to use the 8 wrapper types. Each one of the generic types has a wrapper type, like for instance, integer is the wrapper type for int. And then you basically can create an integer variable that is an array list of integers. But you can still add integers directly to that integer array, because Java has this property called boxing, that it basically detects when you pass an int, for instance, but the method really that takes that value, takes an integer object and automatically wraps that int into an integer object. So it wraps this 5 into a new integer of that it contains the number 5. So, and this is basically a mirror feature. There is also the unboxing feature, which automatically, when you get an element, it unboxes it into the primitive type if you try to assign it to a variable of a primitive type, or you try to use it in a place where the primitive type is needed. So there are basically two features here. That one is that you have the type is already determined, so you can get the element at index 0, and in this case it will be assigned directly to a double variable. But also the fact that you have unboxing, which basically means that if you do try to assign a double object to a variable of the type primitive double, it will automatically convert that double object to the double primitive type. And this is a property of the numeric wrapper types. So 6 out of the wrapper types basically are numeric, ints or reals. And those are unwrapped automatically. So the next topic is how to declare our own generic classes, which is the most important, because we'll spend half of this semester creating data structures, and we want these data structures to be completely generic. So in this case, I'm creating a generic stack. So last year, last course, we actually created lots of generic or general types, like a stack that takes any kind of object. But today we'll actually implement a stack, generic stack, that takes the type of the elements in that stack as a parameter. internally is actually implemented with an array list of the same type of elements E. And then some of the methods in the API are parameterized. And the first one that we see is pick method. The pick method returns the top element in the stack without deleting it. And of course, if we know that the type of elements in the stack is E, then the type returned by the pick method is of the type E. Similarly, the pop method returns the element on the top of the stack and also removes it. And again, since we know that this is a generic stack of the type of elements of the type E, it returns an object of the type E. The push method basically takes an object of the type E, puts it on the stack, and also returns it back as a result. And these are the methods that basically are using the generic type. And this is the implementation. So we declare the public class generic stack of the type E. We can see that internally it uses an array list of the type E, and we initialize that array list. Then the various methods, get size returns the size of the array list, so it's also the size of the stack. The pick method returns the element on the top of the stack, so it's at index get size minus one, and we can get from that array list the element at that index, so the previous to the end of the array list. That's a stack, you always take the element on the top. And the push method pushes at the end of the current array list, so it adds to that array list the object O. And we can see that in the case of pick, it returns an object of the type E, the generic type, and in the case of push, it can only take elements of the type E. So it's parameterized on that type E. Now, if you declare an array list, like in this example, that is an array list of a generic stack of integers, you can only push on it integers and pop integers. In the case of a generic stack of strings, you can only push strings and also pop strings. All the classes that you find in the lecture notes are basically completely implemented and run in Java. So I will just run a few, especially the ones that are new and we never talked about them before. Let's wait for my Eclipse to run. And let's create that class. So we'll call it generic class, generic stack. That's it, we don't need anything else. And basically I'm going to modify it by pasting the code in the lecture notes. So we just created the generic stack, let's test it. So I'm going to create a new class test. And in this case, I will add a main method. And what I'm going to put in it is actually this example in which I create a generic class of integers, a generic class of strings, and then basically test the functionality. So let's run it. Always select all resources. And we basically see that the first stack is a stack of integers, the second stack is a stack of doubles. But again, the most important advantage is really the fact that you get compiler errors. If you try to push something in the first stack that is not in accordance with the type, like for instance, a string, now we will basically get a compiler error. And that basically tells us that the method push can only take integers. It actually tells us there. So it doesn't take strings. So it's actually an improvement in the fact for developers like us that will basically get errors earlier and we don't deliver code that is incorrect. It also is an advantage that we can write these generic data structures where the type is parameterized. It's kind of like in logic, you have second order logic in which the type of a parameter inside the predicate is of a predicate itself. And in functional programming, there are the so-called second-order functions, or basically the fact that you can pass a function as a parameter to another function. In this case, we are passing a type as a parameter to another type. So we know that we can create a stack of any type of elements, but that element is parameterized. So all the methods that we have will work correctly on those parameters. And that's the whole idea of generic programming in any programming language. Now, the second thing that I wanted to talk about is generic static methods. So this is an example of a generic static method. So let's say that we want to print an array of elements, and the array can be of any type, because really what we would like is to be able to print an array of people, or an array of frames, or an array of integers in the same way. And here is an example. So the parameterized type comes after the static keyword and before the return type for that specific method. So a generic static method is a static method where you can place the generic type immediately after the keyword static, and you can use it internally in that method. So I could have created a variable of the type E and assigned it an element of the from the class. In fact, later we'll see that if we want, we can play sorting, and sorting requires a temporary variable, and then you will have to create a temporary variable of the type E and assign to it elements from the array list of the type E. So here we basically have this example of print, which is parameterized on the type E. And we can see that we can create an array of strings and invoke the method print on the array of strings. And now we are telling the program that this is of the type string, so it will basically can only take strings. So let's actually run this program. So like before, we are going to create a new class. And as I said, this is a generic method class. And what it does, basically, it prints elements of the type, of a type, certain type. Okay. And if we run it, it basically prints the string hello and again. And we basically do it in two different ways. The first way is that we specify that we are calling the method print, which is parameterized on the type string. Or for backward compatibility, we can just call print of the variable s3. So it automatically infers that since this is an array of strings, the method will be parameterized on string. So basically, these are the two different ways to invoke static methods which are parameterized on the type. Now, another very common implementation of generics is to actually bound the generic types. So let's say that we want superclasses of a class, or we want subclasses of a certain class. Like, for instance, we want a method equal area, but equal area should work on all the subclasses of geometric objects. It shouldn't work on basically other classes. Moreover, it should only work on types which are the same. Like, for instance, I can compare for equal area a square with a square, or I can compare for equal area a square with a circle, or a circle with a circle, or a circle with a square. So how can we do that? We basically can bound the type E to any subclass of a geometric object. And at this point, we don't need to do casting anymore. So what we can see is that we can take the two objects, object 1 and object 2 of the type E, And then since we know that geometric object has abstract method get area, it doesn't matter what's the actual type of object one, we can just invoke for object one get area and for object two get area because it's also of the type E that extends geometric object. And now in our main method, basically we can create a rectangle and a circle and compare their areas. So this is a bounded generic type. This method is based, this static method is a generic static method like we had before. It basically takes any objects that are subclasses of generic object, of geometric object. So again, I'm going to copy it and test it in Eclipse. So my class test is the best place to put it. I will delete the current implementation. And now we basically have this. So rectangle creates a, So last semester we had these classes, rectangle and circle, but I do not have the implementation here. Let me actually implement it fast because we probably will need it. So first of all, we have geometric object. And we can declare it as abstract. And one of the methods that we wanted to put here, let's say that there are no other methods, is public boolean equal area. And this is a static method. Now we can parameterize it on anything that extends geometric object. And it basically takes two geometric objects of the type E. So let's call it O1 and O2. And as we saw in the example, we'll basically compare the two objects by comparing their areas. So one other thing is let's define public abstract bubble get area. It's basically it's a dynamic method and it will be implemented by any subclass of this of geometric object. So now we can basically declare our return if object one got get area is exactly the same with object two got get area. So in this case, basically this is geometric object. Let's create the two subclasses of geometric object. We'll again need them later today. So let's create them once. Triangle. Actually, let's create rectangle. And it has double width. One by default, private double and private double height equal one. And we have a constructor x width and height. And it initializes this dot width with width and this dot height with height. Now we are not done. Basically, we still need to implement the method get area because if this class extends geometric object, we will get an error that not all methods are implemented. And the method that we should implement is public boolean, actually double get area, and it returns the product in this case of width multiply with height. Okay. And similarly, we can declare another class and I'm going to create the class circle. And again, I'm going to implement private double radius equal with 1 by default. And then we have a public circle that takes a double radius. And this dot radius is assigned with radius. And again, because this class extends symmetric object, we'll basically have to implement the getArea method. It will return map.py multiplied with the radius square. So that's radius. Okay, so now our main method should work. So in test, we were basically comparing the areas of two objects, and they don't have the same area because we are comparing a rectangle with a circle of different sizes. Okay. So now more static methods that use generic types, sorting an array of objects. So we can develop a generic method for sorting an array of comparable objects, and generic sort is the in this case. We define a public static method sort that takes any object E that extends comparable of E. So basically we can specify the fact that it's a class that implements a method or the comparable interface, but moreover, it specifies that the type that it will take as a parameter of the compare to method must also be of the type E. So you can only compare strings with strings, dates with dates. You cannot compare incompatible objects. That's what basically this says, that E must be a type that implements comparable for the type E. So it's parameterized. Even the fact that it implements comparable is parameterized. It has to implement comparable for the same type. And that's the advantage of basically this. So here we have the sort method, and it's implemented using a selection sort. I will not go into details, but basically I define an element current mean of the type E and current minimum index of the type integer. And then in a for loop for every position, it assigns to the current minimum the element at index I and the current minimum index I. And then it iterates from I plus 1 to the length of the array, compares every element with the current minimum. And then it, if it's not still the current minimum, it basically reassigns the current minimum and the current minimum index to J. And go ahead.
So I just want to clarify with the slide before sorting an array of objects, like this one. So can you, if you say like E extends geometric objects, so you can put like rectangle and circle, like both of them, like it doesn't have to be like either circle or rectangle, like it can be both?
Yes. And actually, so what's happening is that this is due to that type erasure in Java. So basically what happens is that it takes any type of objects that extend geometric objects. So this is why it takes rectangles and circles, because The truth is that this could be variables of any subtype of geometric object. So it cannot infer, and Java doesn't have this feature that you can specify that this is exactly the same type subclass of geometric object. So it's a result of the way that Java implements generics.
Oh, okay, thank you.
So you will not get an error. You can compare rectangles with circles, but they all have to be subclass of geometric object. And this is due to the way that Java implements generics. It's probably not something that one wishes in all cases, that they would, someone might want to write, okay, this method only compares circles with circles, but it's not possible to do in Java such a thing. Okay.
Thank you, Professor.
Not a problem. Maybe now it's a good moment to do the quiz for the day. So generic stack with array, well, basically it's a re-implementation of generic stack, which we implemented it earlier, and I will go to back, but it's implemented with arrays instead of array list. But still, it has to be generalized to the type E. So I already implemented it on my other computer, but unfortunately, since it's still updating, I will just re-implement it again. So we create a generic stack with array. And now we parameterize it to the type E. So when someone would want to create an object of this class, it must be parameterized on that type. So it has to implement the standard methods for array lists, for stacks. Basically, we'll create an array of objects. We cannot assign it the type E, an array of the type E, because the type E will not be known, and we'll talk about this a little bit later towards the end. So first of all, we have an array of objects, and this will be basically, let's say, a new array of object of 10 elements. Let's start with 10 elements. And the reason why we cannot put E here is that, as you will see, it cannot at runtime know what the type E is. So you have to basically go for the bigger type. However, this doesn't mean that you cannot implement the rest of this class correctly. So for instance, the public method pop will basically pop elements of the type E. And the way that we will do that is that basically we'll return. First of all, we need a size. Let me actually do this here. So we need an integer size variable, initially initialized with 0. And let's also make this private. And when we return the object from the array, A of size, we need to cast it, and that's possible, to the type E. So now pop works by returning elements of the type E. Also, public pick will basically work the same way. Picking in the array list, it will basically, in the stack, will pick the element on the top of the stack. One thing that I should have done is pop delete the element from the stack. So let's say that the size is decremented, or actually what we can do is to decrement it here. So it's a post decrement. First it returns the element at index size. Actually it should be size minus 1, and then it decrements the size. So let's do it this way. And here, instead of decrementing, just minus 1. And finally, we need a method for push. So public takes it doesn't return anything. So public void push basically takes an element of the type E. And now because it's an array, we have to check if there is still more size in that array. So if the size of the stack is greater than equal with the size a.length, then we'll basically create a new array of the of objects. Let's call it T for temp, is a new object array. And the number of elements is a.length multiplied with 2. And we need to copy the elements from the old stack to the new stack. And in this case, I will just do it manually. So for every integer ID I, starting from 0, as long as I is less than a.length, and I is incremented with 1 after each iteration, T of I is assigned A of I. And once we copied it, we now can redirect the array A towards the array T. And in either case that there was space or not, the size is incremented. But before we do that, we'll basically assign to A of size the element that we wanted to push, which was O. Okay, good. So now let's test it. So generic stack with array. I will basically create a new class. Let's call it test generic stack with array. And in the main method, I'm going to create a generic stack with arrays of ints, of integers. Let's call it S1, and this is a new generic stack array. And now let's parameterize it. And let me make a typo with array. Good. And now we can only push integers to this. So S1 dot push 1 will work, but S1 dot push 1 will not work because it's a string. It basically will tell us that you can't push a string to in this class because it can only take integers. So that's basically what the advantage of generic stacks is. And pop will work similarly. So for instance, I can define int I is equal with s1.pop. And that suffices. I don't need to cast anything to get the element. So if, for instance, I can basically print the element I, and it will print 1, the value that we just pushed. See? So that's basically what I will put it in the recording, and you can implement it for your quiz for the day, generic stack with arrays. I will also go over the problems in the lab at the end of the class. So let's continue with basically other methods of arrays. So you saw the method for sorting, parameterized on the type of elements of comparable, of the same type of element. And here is an example. For instance, you can invoke it for sorting an array of integers or sorting an array of doubles. And it will basically work in the same way. It's parameterized, and we basically you can sort the elements. Now, again, let's actually test it. because I know that Java 1.10 actually made a requirement that you must, if you do parameterize it, you must actually call it with the class name. So I will show you this difference that is quite new, relatively new in Java. So let me create the class generic sort. And basically, first I will copy the method for sorting from the lecture. And okay. Formatting is not working. Okay, looks good. And now the main method for sorting an array of objects. It's basically this one. And you can invoke this method in two different ways. So one way is that you've write it as sort the integer array. One way that was possible before was that you basically write it like this. But if you do want to pass the parameterized type, you have to now precede it with the name of the class. So the way to actually call it now is generic sort dot integer sort. And then it basically this will work. And similarly, where we have sort here is generic sort dot, and now the parameterized type in this case is double. So before it was possible to omit in the same class the name of the class, but that appears as an error now. It's a change that basically happened in Java. Usually Java is backward compatible, however, in this case, Java 9 started to actually have features that are not backward compatible. It makes the language more stricter, but some programs written for Java 8 do not work anymore. And this is one feature, such feature. Another feature is actually casting in reification. If you basically have objects that are in a string and you want to actually obtain the actual object out of it, that will not work anymore. Java changed the way that objects are implemented internally. We'll talk about that more towards the end of the semester when we talk about advanced features in Java like annotations and casting, more complex casting. Okay, good. So what do exactly we had in that sorting method? So here we have the sort method parameterized on the type e extends comparable of e, has two meanings. First is that says that e implements the comparable interface. So it's a subclass of comparable. Second, it specifies that the type of elements that will be compared with it are also of the type e as well. So it basically e extends comparable of e will tell me two things, that is a subclass of comparable and it can only be compared with objects of the same feature, of the same type E, basically a subclass of comparable. Now, the sort method will use the compare to method and basically it can compare integers, doubles, char, because they implement the comparable interface, but so all these objects can be compared using the compare to method. Now, Java 1.5 introduced generics, but prior to 1.5, basically Java was using objects for everything. And an ArrayList would basically be an ArrayList of any kind of objects. That is really roughly equivalent to ArrayList of the parameterized type object. And that's why all of the previous programs still work in Java, because basically it's backward compatible and it allows one to create an array list of any kind of objects. And what backward compatible means is that newer editions of the same programming language, in this case, or any technology, is backward compatible if the input developed for an older technology can still work with the newer technology. Java used to be backward compatible and still is in most respects, as opposed to, for instance, Python, which we all know that Python 3 became more strict, and almost all programs written for Python 2 were stopped to work on Python 3. And the reason was that basically most of the print statements were just print space and the element that is was printed, while in Python 3 now the requirement was that all arguments must be enclosed within parentheses. And really it broke all programs written for Python 2. And at that moment, it actually started to have two different versions of Python for several years. There was the Python 2 implementation and the Python 3 implementation. And some programs would work in either or in one of them. Python 2 was discontinued. It only happened last year. And now, basically, all programs will only work with Python 3. Row type is really unsafe. Basically, we saw this for the max method implemented for compatible types. And here is an example that max takes two comparable objects, is not parameterized on the type E. And of course, it will only work for objects that are basically comparable, that it will basically break if you are trying to find the maximum between a string and an integer. You will get no compilation error, but the program will crash at runtime, which is exactly what we are trying to avoid. If you want to rewrite this comparable, this max, basically, let's implement it here. You can basically state that now I want to compare any object of a type that extends comparable for that type E. And now basically the type of the object O1 is of the type E, and the type of the object O2 is of the type E. So the advantage of this method is that basically now you can only invoke max for elements of the same type. So if you want to compare the maximum for strings, it will only take a string and a string. If you want to compare the maximum for any other type of elements, it will only take that type, like integers. So here is that example, that basically if you try to invoke for that method that we just wrote, and even another thing here, I was returning comparable, but you can return an element of the type E. So if you compare two strings, you want a string as the result. You don't want to cast it anymore to the type string. So an example, let's write here an example. So for instance, what would be the result of system.out.println max 1 of basically two strings, 1 and 2. So now this is parameterized on the type string. So it will basically compare the two strings and returns the maximum as 2. But if you try to compare two different things, it's a syntax error. It will tell you that you can't, basically the type one of one is extends comparable of string, and now the second type cannot be an integer. If you want even more to actually not only infer the type from the type of the elements, but actually, in this case, I'm implementing generic sort. So I can basically say it, sort dot string of max 1. And now it's even more basically correct. It will compare max one and one with two, and it compares it exactly for the type, the generic type string. So E here is string, and it sees string extends comparable of string, which is correct. So that actually solves that problem that was mentioned earlier, of basically that you want to avoid all compiler errors or most compiler errors and in generic types. And in that case, you must have the two types of the same type. And this is a bounded parameterized type. It says that it's any subclass of comparable, but that subclass implements a comparable of the same type E. So E must be a subtype of comparable. And moreover, the type of elements that will be compared with the element of E are must also be of the type E. So that brings us to wildcards. So really, what are wildcards? Wildcards are types, parameterized types, where we want to state that this is a parameterized type of some subclass or superclass, but we are never going to use that variable again. So in scripting languages, like for instance in Bash, regular expressions are basically question mark means a variable, one character. In this case, it's question mark means any type. Question mark extends T means any subclass of the type T. Question mark super T means any superclass of the type T, including T itself. And here is the first example. E extends number is a wildcard that represents number or any subtype of number. And a few examples. So we start first with a main method that basically creates a stack of integers. And you can see that I'm pushing in this stack 1, 2, minus 2. And then the maximum number, I invoke in the method max. The method max takes any generic stack of number, the super type. And of course, the problem here is that number is actually an abstract type. So it expects this is the generic type of stack of numbers. But of course, when you try to actually pass a stack with actual objects like integers or doubles, it will basically try to solve it for doubles. So stack pop will basically return a double, and we return a double value. If the stack is empty, then the value is the double value. If the value is greater than max, then the max is equal with value. And the while loop basically computes the maximum in that stack and returns the maximum from the stack. And in this case, I'm pushing integers in this stack of integers. And I basically will get an error when I try to invoke the method max, because the method max is not defined for integers, it's defined for number. Although integer is a subclass of number, but generic stack of integers is not a subclass of generic stack of number. And we saw actually this last semester with ArrayList. An ArrayList of integers is not a subclass of an ArrayList of doubles. You must have a type that is actually the parameterized type must be actually specified that you have a subclass, any subclass of number. And here is the way to fix it. So max will take a generic stack of any subclass of number. Or another way is so this is basically one way you are basically stating that is any subclass of number. And this will work fine. And let me actually show you the example. So in fact, I will take the entire wildcard demo one. And create an example. So it's wildcard demo 1B. I named the file incorrectly, so let's just rename it. Okay, and run it. And it basically computes the maximum of a stack of integers. Now, another version is to basically take any class as the element of the stack. So basically, this is, I can basically write a different wildcard demo too. And exactly like before, we basically so I'm creating a stack of integers, pushing all of the elements, and then basically printing all of the elements using a wildcard for any element of the type of the element in the stack. And it basically prints the stack. Another demo in which I basically create two stacks, one of strings and the other one of objects. And in one I can put strings, in the other one I can put objects. And adding stack one to stack two will create a stack of objects. So it's basically the add method is generic. It basically takes all of the elements from stack one and puts them into stack two. So it the add method takes a generic stack of elements of the type T and puts it into a generic stack of elements of a type that is a superclass of T. Or I can rewrite the same program by stating that it takes a generic stack of elements of the T of subclasses of T, so question mark extends T, and puts them in a generic class of elements of the type T, which is the next implementation. So you see basically here I'm stating that I'm taking one stack of elements that are subclasses of T and puts them in the class in the stack of elements of the type T, while the other implementation is I'm taking elements from a stack of elements of the type T and I'm putting them into a generic stack of elements of the of a superclass of T. So these are two different ways to implement exactly the same, that you want all the elements from one stack to be added to the other stack. Okay, and I basically will run this again, just to show that it works. So let's make sure that everything works perfectly. And it works, the first one, and wildcard demo 3. I already have a tree. Okay, so I will just use this one. And it's exactly the same way it runs. So really the difference between the two is that in this version I'm taking a stack of subclasses of T and a stack of T. And in the other version, I'm taking a stack of T and a subclass, a superclass. A stack of superclass of T, but basically the behavior is the same. I'm taking the elements from the stack one and putting them into the stack two. Okay, and that's basically this example. Okay, good. So in summary, basically any class has superclasses, and you can use basically question mark super. Question mark means any object in Java, and E extends, question mark extends E means any subclass of E. Now if you have parameterized types, also parameterized, so like comparable of E or a comparable of question mark, you basically use the same hierarchy. So question mark means really a subclass of any type of elements. Question mark extends B means a sub. The class E takes parameters, parameterized types of any subclass of B. And here we have an example where we have any superclass of B. Okay, so how is this implemented in Java? So Java uses a methodology called type erasure. It means that the compiler does the type checking, but once it's done with type checking and everything is type correct, it erases the type and there is only one version of the generic data structures available at runtime. And this basically was done so it's still backward compatible with the stacks and array lists of any type of objects that was before. And really, that's why at runtime, after it does all the checking necessary, it basically it transforms the program into a program that has objects as the type of array lists or any other data structure, and it adds casting wherever is necessary, because we forgot the type of the elements. So these translations are done internally. You don't see them, but basically they eliminate the use of all of the parameterized types. All of the parameterized types are changed to object, and the compiler also adds casting wherever necessary. Even examples like E extends geometric object is transformed into geometric object everywhere where E was used. So it's really any subclass of geometric object, including geometric object. So it's important to note that all of these classes are going to use the same implementation. And basically, this can be visible when you try to do operations like instance of. So for instance, you can check if stack one was a stack of strings and check two was a stack of integers. You can check if these are stacks, but you cannot check that stack one is an instance of generic stack of string, because basically this is forgotten by the type that is instance of is executed. So basically you cannot remember the type at runtime. And there are many restrictions, and I will go over all of these restrictions. The first restriction is because we forgot the type at runtime, you cannot create objects instances of that generic type. You cannot say in a method that has the generic type E, new E, because E is forgotten. You don't know the type at runtime. That's why in my implementation of stack, generic stack that uses arrays, I basically created an array of objects, not an array of E, because E is forgotten at runtime. So similarly, you cannot create a generic array of the type E. So this would be not allowed because you don't know what's the type E. So you can have to create a generic array of objects. Another restriction is that since all the instances of the generic class have the same type at runtime, the static variables and methods of a generic class are shared by all the instances. So if E is the generic type, you cannot define a static method that uses E, either internally or as a parameter, because this is a static method. It's basically a method made for that specific class, not a method that is linked to any instance that has the type E as a parameter, as a type parameter. So this would be illegal because this is a static method. This would be illegal because this is a static data field, and this is a group of static data fields and is also illegal. So these are all compiler errors in Java. Another restriction is that exception classes cannot be generic, because basically at runtime you cannot catch a specific type of exception that is parameterized, since the parameter is actually lost because of the type erasure at compilation time. So it's impossible to actually know what the type E was or TE was, because this type information is not present at the runtime. And now a final example of using generic classes for a matrix. So matrices are basically matrices of objects, of basically values. They are used in mathematics for implementing matrices of integers, matrices of rational numbers. So in this case, I will use a generic matrix, which is takes the generic type E as a parameter, and then we'll implement the matrix of integer and the matrix of rational numbers. So the generic matrix takes any subclass as a generic type, any subclass of, let me decrease the size so you can see the top, any subclass of the type number. And basically, you can see that the add method is parameterized on the type E, the multiply method, the zero is parameterized, and then we have actual methods to adding two matrices, multiplying two matrices, and so on. So adding two matrices, the two matrices must be of the same sizes. We are creating a new matrix of the same length and width. Basically, matrix of zero of length is the width of the matrix. And then in a two for loop, in nested for loops, we iterate over all the rows and all of the columns. And the result of ij is the addition of matrix 1 of ij and matrix 2 of ij. And similarly, basically, if you want to multiply two matrices, you will basically check the width of the first matrix is equal with the height of the second matrix, and then you create a matrix for the multiplication and you do the standard multiplication of matrices. And I will jump directly to integer matrices. So an integer matrix extends generic matrix for integers. So you see, you can even use in inheritance the parametric type. And then you basically, the add method is parameterized for integers. So we add two integers or we multiply two integers. And then we have the main method that adds or multiplies matrices of integers. So just to give the entire execution, let's create the generic matrix class. And the generic matrix class is implemented exactly the way that we have it in the lecture notes. So let me copy it. Okay. And we have the adding method. We have the multiplying method. Then we have the print method. And we have the other classes. And let's actually put them all in one class. It makes it much easier in one file. I'm going to create another class for integer and the main method in this class. In fact, let's put the main method in the generic class. And let's see. I do. No, that's not what I wanted. No. Let's actually call it in the same class of generic matrix. Of dot integer. Okay, that should solve. That should have solved the first problem. Ah, we have other errors. Okay. Generic matrix. Oh, this should be abstract. That's it. Now, some of the errors went away. Ah, we forgot the generic type. Okay, and now we don't need this. In the version that I will put on the public website will be the version that actually works and it's correct. So one thing that I noticed was actually it seems to be correct no matter what. Okay, good. Okay, good. Now consider that you have a class rational that implements, that extends number and implements comparable for rational, has a numerator and denominator, and implements the methods for add and multiply. All that you need to do for a stack of for a matrix of rationals would be to basically declare a rational matrix that takes the parameter rational. And then basically now you have addition, multiplication of rational matrices. And here is an example. And again, this will work out of the box, in fact. So in fact, I can use it in the same file. So let me actually do it so I finish this. I know that we are in the lecture over time, but I want to finish it. We still have the lab going afterwards, so it doesn't matter. So we have the rational, then we have the implementation of a rational class, and we have the rational matrix. And the main method in rational we should finish this method here. Okay. Good. And now the main method, we can change the main method in the main class generic matrix. So we have here, I will just delete this main method and complete the main method that we have for testing rational matrices. And run the whole thing again. And I had an error somewhere. Let's see where it is. Okay, let's see what are the unimplemented. Ah, the unimplemented methods are the default ones in the class, in basically the number class, int value, long value, and so on. So it should, let's see. The denominator. Ah, we still need to implement those two methods. So we have two more methods here. Public. Long get numerator that returns numerator and the similar method for denominator. Now this must be complete. And it basically does multiplication and addition of rational matrices. So that's all for the lecture for today. We basically did everything to give you the basis of generic types in Java. And following the class, try to implement the lab for the day. The lab for the day should be easy because basically these methods are already in the lecture notes. Sorting of an array is done. Please do the sorting of an array list. Largest element, we have maximum for an array. You can do it for an array list. And finally, the same way that I implemented a matrix of rational numbers and the matrix of integers, implement a matrix of complex numbers, where a complex number has a real part and an imaginary part. And that's basically the lecture today. Any questions? Okay, so it seems that all questions were actually responded by other students. Like, for instance, where do you use generics in data structures mainly, and sometimes in generic methods? And that seems that all questions were answered. Generic methods must be static, so yes. Generic methods must be static. You can have generic classes, which may have methods, which are basically with parameters that were the generic type. But in essence, if you talk about generic methods, they must be static. You can't have generic dynamic methods. So I will respond to some of these questions after I stop the recording, okay? So let me stop the recording.